Thanks a lot, Java. Thanks a lot for all of you for being here. I'm very happy to see many of you, and I already had the chance to meet some of you last night, so it was I really have a great time until now. So in this first talk, I'm going to tell you something about arsenic. It's one of my two most favorite elements, apart from selenium. And of course, I'm also very grateful to the European Association of Geochemistry who make this all possible, that I could come here and meet you guys. So I work in two different places. I work in ETH Zurich. It's a technical school, one of the technical schools of Switzerland. But I also work at EAWAC, which is a Swiss Federal Institute of Aquatic Science. So I have two desks, two places. Today's talk will be more, or this morning's talk will be more about the water phase, and in the afternoon we will go to the whole world, more or less. This is just a brief overview of the kind of work we do in my groups. It's called the Inorganic Environmental Geochemistry Group. The main goal is to understand the factors, processes, and sources that control biogeochemical cycling and environmental distribution of trace elements. And we do this using different approaches, like we do lab studies. We have a strong focus on analytical development, analytical chemistry, in which we use different techniques to analyze trace elements as well as their species. We do field studies in different areas of the world. We also analyze the samples back in the lab that we take. We use this information together with other information that is already available, because there's a lot of information already out there, to make models. So with these models, we try to put our knowledge from the lab scale to a wider perspective. So this is the way that we work, and today I will talk a little bit about the modeling part. And the topic here now is arsenic. And I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with arsenic, but I just start a very brief introduction why we care about arsenic. The problem is that we are exposed to a longer time, so over a number of years, to waters containing arsenic, drinking water. This can lead to arsenic poisoning, or it's also called arsenicosis. And there are different problems associated with that, different diseases, like diseases of the blood vessels, diabetes, and different types of cancer that can develop after consuming water that contains arsenic over a long time scale, like over a number of years. And I talk about water because water is a main exposure route of arsenic to human populations. And it's not only because of drinking the water, but also of using the water to cook. For example, when you cook rice in Asia, there may be arsenic in the water, and this can also affect the get to elevated arsenic levels in your food as well. So a short background on why arsenic is a problem. I guess that most of you know this image, the periodic table of the elements, I hope. the reason that arsenic is such a big problem for us is its location in the periodic table. And as you can see, it is just located in the same group as phosphorus. And phosphorus is a very essential element for life, for all organisms. And we know that the elements in the same group, they have similar chemical characteristics. So this can happen that, and go to the next slide, that some of these species that arsenic forms are similar to the phosphorus species, and particularly arsenate, which is the main oxyanion, or the most oxidized form of arsenic, we see here. And here we see the structure of phosphate. And you can see that they are very similar. And that means that organisms cannot distinguish between these two forms. So if you are in an environment with high arsenic and you want to take up phosphate, then you will also take up this species. There's no way to deal with that. This is just the last slide. I know that we are not in life science here, but just a very brief picture in how this works. Here we have a cell, so this can be a human cell, for example. And these are all different metal and metalloid transporters. So metals and metalloids are actually very important in our human body. Like, we need many of these elements for proteins. Around 50% of the proteins contain a metal. So this is how important metals are for us. But unfortunately, some of these transporters that can bring in some of these elements can also bring in arsenic. And that's largely, again, due to the similarity of this arsenic species to phosphate. So the most toxic form, at least in waters, is arsenite, is the trivalent form of arsenic. And we will talk later about that this is also one of the main forms, unfortunately, that we find in our environment. So I was talking about groundwater, and I'm starting here with a very big overview of areas in which we know that arsenic or elevated levels of arsenic are a problem in groundwaters. And this map shows different locations. We see here in this larger areas are arsenic-affected aquifers, or very large aquifers. And these different spots, the red ones contain are arsenic related to mining and mineralization, and the green geothermal water. So we see they're spread out in the world. We have many places where we have a problem with arsenic in the world. And we will look mainly at this area today, because here's where we have the most issues related to arsenic exposure to human populations. But first I want to go a little bit into the mechanisms, like, why do we have arsenic release in the first place to the water? And there are two types of mechanisms. The first one is when we have high conditions of pH and oxidizing conditions. So you can expect these kind of conditions in arid regions. For example, in Argentina, there are big problems in aquifers where we have oxic conditions and high pH. And the reason is that there is, when we have higher pH, as some of you probably know, you have also more OH minus groups, and they are competing to sorb to minerals. Because arsenic, this form here, arsenate, is a species that is very much sorbed to minerals or to organic matter in aquifers, but also in soils. And of course, when you have high pH, you have a lot of OH minus groups, and then you have less chance to get a partner to stick to, right? So this is why you see here we have 100% sorbed here at this point. And then when we go to very high pH, this is being released, and it is into the water phase at that point. So this is one specific mechanism of how arsenic can be elevated in waters and soil solutions also. And then there's a second one, and that is under reducing aquifer conditions. So I just want to ask you, like, who is familiar with this type of diagrams, poor bed diagrams? A few. Okay, so I will briefly explain how it works. Actually, this is a great tool, because this is a kind of crystal ball. We can kind of predict what kind of species we have under certain conditions. So it's really great to use this tool. So here we have redox conditions, so how reducing or oxidizing the system is. So we can imagine the more oxidizing we are in the atmosphere, in the ocean, in surface waters. But then when we are more going down along this axis, we come under more reducing conditions, such as groundwaters or maybe soils that are waterlogged. So this is kind of an indication of how reducing or how oxidizing the system is. And here we have the pH, as you probably all know, very important, like the master variable for explaining which species are there. And we see here two important forms, these oxyanions. So we have arsenate, arsenic 5, with an oxidation state of plus 5, and arsenite, arsenic 3. And as we look at this diagram, we see in more oxidizing conditions, we have this form, arsenate, and more reducing conditions, we have this form, arsenite. And then also when we go lower into the system, here also sulfur is indicated, we come under more reducing conditions and where we form, for example, sulfides, as you can see here. So this is a great way to kind of, even if we don't do any arsenic measurement yet, when we have information about these two parameters, we can make a first prediction. Of course, this is just thermodynamics, it's not kinetics, but it gives us a first hint. So under these reducing aquifer conditions, and I will come back to that later, what we have is that and under near-neutral pH values, like here, what we can have is we can reduce these arsenate form into arsenite. And there's one big difference between these two species. Can you tell me what the difference is, just from looking at this diagram?
Dissolving more in water.
Yes, so this one is more, let's say, soluble, because this one is more sticking or is more adsorbed to sediments. Why would that be the case? It's the absolute correct answer. So why would that be the case? What is the difference between these two? Apart from the one hydrogen extra. Okay, I will help you a little bit. Like, the difference is that okay, I will just freshen it up a little bit. Okay, so we have here, it's a negatively charged species, so it has a charge. And this means that this can actually absorb to positively charged surface sites at minerals. So we have absorption of this one, and this one is uncharged, so it is released into the water phase. Great. Okay, so we have these two conditions, right? Briefly, let's go why we have reducing conditions to maybe also refresh your memories. So microorganisms play a very important role in the natural environment in general, but also in establishing these conditions in aquifers or in soil systems. So they use reduced carbon as an electron donor, and then they need an electron acceptor to make the redox reactions happen. And in an oxic environment, like we are here today, luckily there's oxygen, because I cannot live of anything else, but microbes can actually use other electron acceptors. So when we are in an environment like here, we have oxygen, but then when you can imagine you have a closed system and you have organic carbon being put in, like in an aquifer, for example, where you don't have a lot of communication to the outside world, then you have microbes that start reducing certain mineral or certain species to get energy from. So first, oxygen is there. When that is used up, they start reducing nitrate. Then manganese oxide is being reduced. Then when there's still a lot of organic carbon present, we have iron oxide or iron hydroxide reduction, sulfate reduction, and at the end we can also form methane. So, and as you can see, this is the favorability of these different communities. So this means that when iron hydroxide, which is a very important player in the arsenic world, because the arsenic or arsenate is sorbed to iron hydroxide minerals, when these start dissolving, then you don't have anything more to add. So then also the arsenic is being released into the water. And in the same time, the arsenic is also reduced by itself. So you have arsenate to arsenite. So you have kind of the two effects of reductive dissolution of iron oxides and reduction of arsenate to arsenite. I hope that's more or less clear to you guys. Okay, so now we have done the background and we can go to the fun part. Now we understand all of the background. So where do we have these problems occurring? And because I knew that, of course, I would be here today, I just made a very brief look into what happens in the Pannonian Basin, because the Pannonian Basin maybe you have seen it on the map before, is one of the regions where we have elevated arsenic concentrations in groundwater. And this is, of course, not just in Hungary, but it has been estimated that around 400,000 to 500,000 people in the Greater Hungarian Plain are affected by higher arsenic concentrations. There are different reasons for that. There's the reductive dissolution mechanism at play, but we also have geothermal waters that are important. I'm not an expert on this at all, but I think it's just important to mention that this is also an important place where we have this problem. But when we look more on a worldwide, like on a global scale, we see that most of the people that are affected by arsenic, too high arsenic in their water resources, are living in Asia. So this is the WHO limit of arsenic in groundwaters. It's 10 ppb or 10 micrograms per liter. So it is thought that if you are below this limit, you are safe, more or less, and if you're over it, you are exposed to high arsenic. And 130 million in the world have been estimated to be exposed to levels higher than this WHO limit. And of this 130 million, 50 million are actually exposed to levels over 50 ppb. And this is actually not a coincidence, this standard, because there are many countries in the world that cannot adopt this guideline, because partly they either don't have the technology to analyze it low enough or to remove the arsenic enough that we can go to this level. Okay, and of those 50 ppb, people who are exposed over this level, 90% are in Asia. And the first case that was discovered or on a large scale in Asia was the case of Bangladesh. And Bangladesh is a very flat country. I mean, I'm from the Netherlands, so I know what flat means, but we have different conditions, of course. But this is very flat as well. And groundwater is a very important source of drinking water in Bangladesh, not only for drinking, but also for cooking. And here we see a study by the British Geological Survey from 2000, where you can see arsenic concentrations measured in these wells, so in these tube wells. We have here the red points are over 50. Then there's this kind of yellowish color. I hope you can see it. It's over 5. So we see quite a number of wells that have high arsenic concentrations in Bangladesh. And this has been referred to as the biggest mass poisoning in history, because the first idea to put in these tube wells was to provide safe drinking water, because groundwater is normally seen as a safe resource. There are no nasty bacteria there, as you find in surface water. But in this case, there was another toxic element in the water. I'm just going to show you in a cartoon how it works and why this is such a problem in Bangladesh. Here we see Bangladesh. It's flatter than this, but okay, I cannot extend towards here. See here the Himalayas, and which is of course a very big and very young mountain chain. A lot of erosion is happening in the Himalayas, and that plays a very important role why we have this problem. So we have arsenic present in different minerals, for example in pyrite, or associated to pyrite. And I'm not saying that the Himalayas are a bomb of arsenic, that's not the case. But you have a lot of erosion of lots of fresh material coming in that may contain some arsenic, right? So it's more the conditions here that cause the problem and not so much here. Okay, and then we start eroding it, transporting it, oxidizing it, and we have this kind of still reduced species that are out there in the water. This is the toxic form, arsenite, arsenic 3. And then here we are forming iron hydroxide or iron oxides, which are actually taking up arsenic, sorbing arsenic. And why are we forming this iron oxide? Because it's very, this is in German for the people who speak German. It's very low solubility of iron oxide. So as soon as you oxidize iron 2 to iron 3, you will form a solid phase. So we have here arsenic or arsenate is being adsorbed to this iron oxide. Until now, there's no problem. It's not in the water. It's sorbed to the sediment particles. However, in the lower part of the delta, we have very slow groundwater movement. We have a lot of organic carbon, fresh organic carbon, and we have reducing conditions that are being built up there. And then is where we start reducing these phases again, dissolving the iron oxide, and then we release this toxic form of arsenic in the water again. So this is where we have our problem. Well, now I know that many of you are interested in geology, so of course I want to tell you something about these different ages of the aquifers. There are two main aquifer ages in this Asian subsurface geology. We have very young aquifers from the Holocene era, where we have, so from the last 10,000 years to the present, we have a lot of fresh organic material. We have very fine-grained sediments, like silt sediments that are freshly transported from the higher mountain chains in the back. We have a lot of amorphous mineral phases, and that means you have a lot of sorption possibilities. If you have nice crystalline minerals, you cannot sorb so much on it. We have reducing conditions for the reasons that I showed you before, and we have here more elevated arsenic concentrations. So this is all a very general picture. Then in the older aquifers, like from the Pleistocene age, we have it was much colder, it was the last ice age, and we have less organic material. We have very coarse material because there was a huge gradient. You have like more gravel and sands, more crystalline material, oxic conditions, and generally low arsenic concentration. So this is a very general distinction which can help you. If you know you have Holocene sediments, you may have arsenic, and Pleistocene, you may not. But the picture is not as simple as I will show you later. So these are the factors that are influencing this contamination. I talked about Bangladesh before, but we also know about these areas. They also contain high arsenic groundwaters. And they all have the same things in common. They're low-lying areas, very slow groundwater movement, reducing groundwaters, organic sediments, and very young sediments, so from the Holocene era. So what we thought is when we have this information, maybe we can predict areas for which we do not have measurements of arsenic. Because to go out and take a sample, bring it back in the lab to make sure that you have still the right conditions, and then measuring your sample is very, very costly. So we thought it would be great if we can use this information to make a prediction where we are likely to find arsenic in the groundwater and where. So basically to pinpoint areas where we can say, okay, this may be a problem, that we can go there and investigate it in detail. So I'm just going to show you a little bit how we did these kind of predictions. So we have information on geology, on soil, on land use, all kind of information that we have on a very broad scale, like in this case, global or regional scale. And then we have our known concentrations. So what we can do is when we know in what parameters are for these different points, we can see if there's a link. Like if we always have the same geology, then this may predict always high arsenic, yes or not. So we extract the information for these different points that we have. So the first task was actually the most difficult task was to actually make a homogeneous geological map. Here we see a map of Cambodia. I'm not showing you the classes, but it's quite complex. And as maybe some of you realized, geology always ends at the border. it's very interesting because often when you take a neighboring country and the geology completely doesn't match up. So you have to do some interpretation in this case. So what we did is we could make a new sediment map doing some interpretation, using geological maps for these specific countries. We didn't have all countries, that's why there are some white areas here. And we see here, these are mainly, of course, the younger geologies. We are not so interested in very old geology or in areas where you don't have any groundwater wells, for example. Okay, and then we also had to do something to the data, because as you can see here, the data is quite heterogeneous. You have here maybe a red well, but next to it is a blue well. So you have a high arsenic, next to it is a low arsenic well. There may be different reasons. Maybe the well is tapping a different aquifer, or maybe there are small-scale processes. We don't know. But this is a problem, of course, to make these predictions. So we binarized and aggregated the data here. And here you can see the result. We have here the blue points are lower than 10 ppb, so the WHO limit, and the red ones are higher than 10 ppb, so high versus low. Then we put all of that together in a nice model. It's a logistic regression exercise to find relationships between the parameters. And these were the ones that came out as most important. Like here we have delta sediments. Whenever we had delta sediments, we found higher levels of arsenic. And then there was all these different classes, geology and soil classes, that were important to predict arsenic, yes or no. So what we did then is we used this information to make probability maps that show us the likelihood of having a high arsenic concentration, high meaning more than 10 ppb. So here you can see the red colors are areas where we think the likelihood is high to have arsenic, and the blue where we have very low probability of finding high arsenic levels. Of course, we already knew Bangladesh, so it's not so interesting, but it's interesting to evaluate how good we are, of course, because we have to know if our prediction makes sense in the first place, right? And this is the result. So here you see the red areas, the pink areas are areas that we predicted to be high, and the dots are again the measurements here. And the blue is the same, so low prediction, low measurement. So okay, great. And we were 75% correct in our job. But we were not always that correct in what we did, because sometimes we have blue areas in the red, or we have blue dots in the red and red dots in the blue. So that means we are wrong with our prediction. Luckily, we had more blue dots in the red, meaning we predict arsenic, but there is no arsenic there. And one very important role or reason is the geology, like the thickness of the geology. Because what we did, we used surface geology. But when your well is not tapping into that surface geology, but something underneath, your prediction can be completely wrong. So, just showing this in a cartoon image. We have here these two cases, high risk, but no arsenic, and arsenic here. So this is a very typical case we see. Geology is not always nice and straight. Some of you may know, we have different shapes, we have different thicknesses. So if the geology is not thick at all, the Holocene, but our well is located here, we can tap into older geology and we don't have a problem. So the thickness is important. Now just briefly to the main result of the map. So we, apart from the known areas, we could identify some new areas such as the Irrawaddy Delta in Myanmar. So in the last years there have been some studies done, and indeed there is also high arsenic levels in this delta environment. So it was a good way to direct the research to that area. At that time, the political situation was not very good in Myanmar, so we decided not to go there and test it, but to go to another place. So we went to Sumatra in Indonesia, and we went to an area where we have both high and low risk areas. And this is the city of Palembang, where we went to actually take groundwater samples. So here you have Thomas. He was a student who came along. He was the big hero of the campaign. And then it was really interesting because we already saw our map in the field. So we saw the reducing areas looked more or less like this, the red areas, and the blue areas, the more oxidizing areas, looked more or less like that. So it made a lot of sense, we thought. But then when we went back in the lab and we analyzed the arsenic concentrations using ICP-MS, and then we plotted them, we saw, oh, we have lots of low arsenic wells, also in the red area. This is, of course, great for the people who live there, but it was not so good for us because our model is not right in this way. And there's a very specific reason for that, and that is because the Holocene layer is much thinner in Sumatra than, of course, in Bangladesh. And this is the Cenozoic sediment depth, and you see here, this is Bangladesh, you don't even see it, it's so red, so you have huge sediment thicknesses in that in those times, but here we have here Sumatra and you have much less thicknesses. So there's a limitation to the model. It only works when what we have at depth is also what we have at the surface. Yeah, here I'm just showing you very briefly the map for this area, and you can see here a lot of these older geologies showing up. We should have known that before, right? Probably, but we didn't. Okay, the story about the Myanmar pollution was picked up quite a lot in press, which was actually good because you can say, yeah, okay, it's just sensation, but at the end, when people pick up a story, they may also go and look for it. So this is actually what happened, so that is great. But we still have a problem. We have a problem with our prediction, because we were limited by the geology, not knowing the depth. So we did another exercise to actually include geology at depth, so kind of 3D geology. And we were very fortunate to be able to do that in the Red River Delta. Here we in northern Vietnam, here. Here we see Hanoi. And as you can see already on this picture, it's a very flat area. There are many people living there. It's very densely populated, typical delta area, a very fertile soil, so a lot of water available, so lots of population living in these areas. And we were very fortunate that we could do this study here. So we did this in collaboration with the Hanoi University of Science, and we sampled wells in all these places. And so we basically went somewhere and said, "Okay, can we sample your well to have a good distribution of samples?" I know you cannot read the numbers, but it's just to show that we have many different locations. Interesting was that the well depths are very different, and depending where you are in the delta, we have here very shallow wells, and here we have much deeper wells. The geology here, the younger sediments are much thicker here, but there's one other reason, which is that the higher layers are, or aquifers are contaminated with salty water because we are close to the ocean. So they are drilling their wells much deeper where they have less saline waters. Okay, and these are the results of the arsenic concentrations here. We see highest concentrations are in this area along the Red River course where we have fresh sediments, we have a lot of organic material there, we have reducing conditions, and we found that 27% of the wells contains higher arsenic levels, which would affect 3 million people, of course, if they would not use filters to remove the arsenic. We also see, of course, organic matter concentrations much higher in these areas, as we expect in reducing environment. And here, this is actually quite nice, because this redox ladder, this is just a nice concept, and it works thermodynamically, but the question is also, kinetics plays a big role, and many of these redox reactions are very slow. And this is actually showing it what a real redox ladder looks like based on our field data. So we basically just plotted our redox potential measurement to normalized concentrations of the elements that we found in the different wells. And as you can see here, you are a very oxic environment. You have hardly any of these elements present. But when you start reducing, you start first releasing manganese, So manganese oxide is being reduced. Here we have iron coming up under more reducing conditions, just as we would expect here. And then here we see a huge peak of arsenic together with phosphate, of course, which has a very similar structure. So it's also released at the same time. So this is what a real redox ladder looks like. So not from the picture book, but just from the field data. We also looked at many other different elements. So we also have a geochemical atlas for this study, which is in the supporting information, which you can download. We also found other toxic elements, such as manganese. So manganese is an issue related to the development of the brain of children. So too high levels have a very negative effect. And interesting, or actually quite not so good, is that the problem is different than where we have the arsenic, or different areas are affected. So either you have high arsenic or you have high manganese. So there's always some element that is over the limit, the healthy limit. Yeah, but I started off about we are going to see if we can have better prediction using geology at depth. So we had different geological cross-sections available, and here we see the different cross-sections, and here we see the different how it looks at depth. So I'm not going to bother you too much about what these aquifers and aquitards are. It's quite complex, but you can already see it's not straight. So that means that if you use this geology at the surface, you cannot just use surface geology, right? So we used this information in our model, again, with other geology. And I'm just going now to show you a little bit what it looks like when we go down from the surface into depth and how the geology is changing. As you can see here, we have a lot of this Holocene, so younger aquifers. But then when we go deeper, we come into Pleistocene, so older aquifers. So here we have very thin Holocene layers, as I mentioned before. At minus 40 meters, we are almost all in the Pleistocene. And then here we have some Holocene left, and minus 60 meters, we have almost nothing. No Holocene aquifers left. We are in the older geology. And here we have much older geology, which is not indicated. Again, we did a logistic regression analysis to see which ones were the most important factors explaining arsenic, and the lower Holocene aquifer was the most important, which we can see from this value, which indicating kind of the importance in our model. And based on that, we could make a prediction again for the arsenic, elevated arsenic levels, and we can see that it matches quite well with the measured concentration. So we were able to improve our prediction. Now we were 84% correct compared to 75% earlier on. But still, it's not a big jump, right? So even if we just have surface geology, we can already say something. So you don't need, because it's very seldom that you have these great geological sections available for you. So you can still work with the surface geology as well. So this is what it looks like when you stack them. And this is, of course, very interesting. Like when you live, let's say, in Taibin, then we can say, okay, if you want to make a well, maybe don't go at this depth because you may encounter arsenic. To be sure, you have to measure always, but you may encounter arsenic at that depth. So the last story I would like to bring here is that I told you about Pleistocene being very oxidized, very aerated when it was sedimented, but and there's no arsenic contamination, right? Is this the case? Well, that's what we predicted. Well, it turned out that this is absolutely not the case, and especially when you look here close to the city of Hanoi. So here I'm showing you arsenic concentrations in the Pleistocene aquifers, so the kind of what we thought uncontaminated aquifers. And what you can see here is that there are these levels, these contours are showing a water drawdown, groundwater drawdown, close to the city of Hanoi. And the reason is that there's a lot of pumping for the public water supply in Hanoi. So this pipe water, that is a lot of pumping. And this has actually drawn down the water, but also the arsenic, right? So before there was no arsenic, before they started to pump so much. And this is not the only area. Well, this was the first study to show it. And then there were others to show it. For example, in the Mekong Delta, we also have here they were focusing on these specific wells that are between 11 and 50 ppb. And these are quite deep, and they have very high arsenic levels as well. And in this study, they actually found that, again, there was large-scale pumping going on. And this led to compaction of clays, which were containing some of these arsenic. That is actually then released when you start compacting it and it's expelled into the groundwater. With that, I'm coming to the conclusions of the talk. So we have seen that millions of people are at risk of consuming water with excessive amounts of the toxic element arsenic. In many cases, this is natural. And today I just spoke about natural contamination. There's of course also much more human pollution going on in mining areas, and I didn't mention that until now. We can use these geospatial predictions to pinpoint areas that may be at risk of having higher arsenic levels. Of course, when you come up with a risk map, you need to test it to know it for sure. But it is a good indication to know where to look for. And then the last part is that these predictions and other studies, they showed that pumping large amounts of groundwater can lead to arsenic contamination of previously uncontaminated aquifers. So kind of spreading the problem from the natural environment to more like a human action. So here we see it's not just geogenic or natural contamination. When we have human action involved, we change the picture. And this is the case for many different environmental issues, which are not just nature or not just human, but it's a combination of both of them. And with that, I would like to acknowledge the people who have been working on this study from EAWAC, but also from the Hanoi University of Science and the Geological Survey of Vietnam. Then special thanks, of course, to the EAG for making it happen, and of course to Professor Chava Thabo and the lab, and last but not least to you for being here, and I'm very interested to discuss with you.